Hi, everybody. This is Dr. Ed Park, and I'm starting a webinar today on cholesterol. The first slide is entitled Groupthink, Wrong Again. And I think that you just need to throw out everything you know about cholesterol, and trust me that I'm not making this stuff up, because it's such a paradigm shift for most people that they'll just won't get past the premise. And the premise is that cholesterol does not rise because you eat it. And that's surprising. I mean, I say stuff like that, and generally my wife is like, that's ridiculous. So I will attempt to justify that position shortly. When I think about groupthink, I think about things like calcium and vitamin C being helpful for osteoporosis, when in fact that's not exactly true, and you can see why on podcast 6. In fact, excess vitamin D can cause osteoporosis. Back pain and surgery, of course, you know the orthodox recommendation is to do surgery, and you're taking a joint that's supposed to move three ways and fusing it. And I'm not sure that's a good thing, and I don't think that the results clinically bear out a very high satisfaction rate. Thirdly, podcast 14 talks about insulin and fat, and most people think insulin is a bad thing or insulin resistant. They're not really sure how it relates, but they think that fat is bad and that insulin is bad. But it's nuanced, but that's not exactly true. So let's just restate the obvious here, or maybe it's not obvious if you didn't study cell biology or science. Cholesterol is the essential building block of cell membranes in mammals, of something called bile, and of hormones. The actual etymology of this word, choly, is, I'm going to say Greek, for bile. Stereos means solid, and all is alcohol, because it's got alcohol moiety on it. So basically, the word for cholesterol comes from the fact that you can find this yellow stuff in the bile, I guess, is what the old guys, the ancients, noticed. Actually, no, I think it was coined in the 1700s. Okay, this slide is important, and this pretty much sums up my 18 years in clinical medicine. People come in and they say, Doc, here's my labs, and they'll just plop down 80 labs, and they'll say, what do you think? And I'll say, okay. I won't say what I really want to say, which is something that probably Greg House in that show would say, but obviously, the paradigm they have is this, that the body is this control room of precision. You've got your potassium, you've got your white blood cells, you've got your sex hormone binding globulin, and that we need to carefully monitor and adjust these. Indeed, what was once a cottage industry is now a full-blown epidemic of bioidentical hormones, for example. But, I mean, the intuition is good. I mean, of course, you know, these things are important, therefore we need to do what we can to control them. But unfortunately, this is how people view the body. It's a sock drawer. It has to be organized and controlled. And therefore we must take a low-fat, low-cholesterol diet, because in the grand scheme of things, of course, the most important thing is what you eat. You are what you eat. Next important would be genetics. Of course, there are familial syndromes with a high rate of hypercholesterolemia, hypertriglyceridemia, and aging maybe would be like a little tiny peripheral asteroid. So of course, thank goodness we're not in control, because the reality of it is my sock drawer looks like this, and if we had to control our, let's say, potassium level, I'm sure that would be forgotten. If we had to control our testosterone level, our sex hormone binding globulin, I mean, let's face it, you know, we can't keep all those plates spinning. So if you come to me with a big list of labs, you know, I'm going to say, okay, that's good. So what are the clinical goals here? What's the trend? It's called medicine, you know, but people often will actually order up labs, and, you know, they'll just point out abnormalities to me, and I'll say, well, it has to be contextualized. Well, that's what we call practicing medicine. So we learned long ago in training that you don't treat lab values, you treat patients. So that, and to do that, you have to actually listen to them and figure out what's going on, which is something that I think people don't understand when they have this mechanistic view of the body. So it's my contention that the relative importance of in hypercholesterolemia we're talking about today, the biggest thing is cellular aging. I misspelled that, sorry. The second would be your genetics, and the third is diet. Least important. Again, completely antithetical to what everyone knows to be true, which is you are what you eat. And I think when I was thinking about it yesterday, and I was thinking about it from 10,000 feet, and then I was thinking about it from Mars, Marvin the Martian, and the problem is one of agency. Now, what I mean by that is, where is the important level of action, of change, of dynamism? Okay, if Marvin looks down on the humans, he would see a bunch of people who are eating, who are producing various forms of waste, and he might conclude that the things that matter are what we eat and the waste products. If you ask us, we feel that we're important. We feel that we're empowered. We have agency. Our actions can determine what we eat and what we export. But to Marvin, we might just be food processors or, you know, night soil makers. Who knows? So a different way of thinking of it is agency on the level of will. Like, I want to be healthy. So I want to, like, if we talk about democracy being health, well, we're all for democracy, right? But what is the level that democracy comes on? It comes by people moving heavy objects. So, you know, Obama starting an internet campaign, the Clinton coming from Hope, various other candidates, Ross Perot, whatever. All these people, they're agents, and they're incredibly insignificant. They're one cell, but they're incredibly powerful, too, because the level on which all disease function, dysfunction takes place is the cellular level. Okay? Very important concept. So here's some facts about cholesterol. You make a gram or 1,000 milligrams daily, and you have about 35 grams in your body. And the people who recommend taking, or they make recommendations, they just say take 200 milligrams of cholesterol max. Well, I mean, that's totally based on nothing. So the point is, if you need cholesterol and you get absolutely none from your diet, your body will make 1,000 milligrams of cholesterol. And if you get 1,000 milligrams of cholesterol in your diet, theoretically what I'm saying is your body will make 0 milligrams. So it's called homeostasis. Whatever you need, the body will make. Go back to the obesity webinar and you'll see this diagram I made or adapted. And this is the whole point. This is why our intuition is wrong, because if you eat proteins, you'll make fats and carbos. If you eat carbos, you'll make fats and protein. It's a totally interchangeable currency system. And today what we're discussing is fatty acids, but the fundamental pathway is acetyl-CoA, this guy in the middle, these are the $1 bills. You make fat, you make cholesterol, despite what you eat. That's the function of our body, and thank God we're not in control of that, because we would be incompetent at managing such a complex system. And the level of agency, again, is the cells. The cells are in charge of that. That's their job. That's not our job. All right, so what's a lipoprotein? Everyone talks about LDL, HDL. Here's LDL. Here's HDL. So what are these things? A lipoprotein is like a little water balloon. It's got these specialized proteins on the outside that keep the water balloon structure. And then you got these phospholipids, which just means that the polar side or the water-soluble side is outside, so these things can float like the oil bubbles on top of water. But the inside is nonpolar or lipophilic, so that's where all your fat is stored there. So it's really much more simple than you think. LDL is made or packaged by the liver, so this is an outgoing package. Yeah? Coming back to the liver from the body after it's been used for making your cells and everything is HDL. So people talk about good cholesterol and bad cholesterol, vice versa. It's not really. I mean, there's a whole, I learned last night, society called the International Cholesterol Skeptics. And I wouldn't necessarily doubt that what looking at here, what everyone thinks to be true, is actually quite false, which is that these LDL and HDL, there's some level of agency there. They're not. LDL packs is accumulating because of, I believe, cellular dysfunction. You got a lot of fat lying around because the cells aren't using it properly or not signaling a surfeit of it. So when you have HDL, it just means that you're using the stuff efficiently out in the body. Here's some other DLs, again, lipoproteins. So low-density lipoprotein, meaning big old fat bubble. High-density lipoprotein, a lot more smaller fat bubbles, if you imagine oil floating on water. And again, this is how you move around the fatty thing within a water-soluble bloodstream. All right, so what is fat for? Okay, so you eat the fat into the stomach. The gallbladder squirts out this green juice. It coats and surrounds it, and then it's able to cross into the intestine where it goes back to the liver and is packaged for use. So here's a membrane, and this is all of our membranes in every one of our cells. The integrity is, and function is based upon having cholesterol integrated into that. And then they have these things called lipid rafts, which they discovered are little patches. And in these patches are functional proteins, gateways, ion channels, signalers. These are like little patches floating on a pond or a little lily pad. So you can't have these without cholesterol. This is a chart that we had to memorize back at Beth Israel, a lovely chart. And I'll just draw your attention to what should be shockingly obvious. This is a four-ring structure, A, B, C, D. This is cholesterol. Okay? And it can be made from, again, that currency, the acetyl-CoA. It is made. So what you see here is that the first thing it's made is pregnenolone. If you go through these reactions, you get progesterone, you get cortisol. Down here, cortisol. If you convert this reaction, you get cortisol. This reaction, aldosterone. So aldosterone keeps your kidneys from losing salt and your blood pressure up, and cortisol does the same thing, but it's also a stress hormone. If you go down this pathway to the 17-20 lace, and 17 and 20 is just which carbon numbers, you got DHEA, which people come with their lab to say, "Doc, my DHEA is low, I'm going to take some DHEA." Oh, okay. And then that gets converted to androstenedione. Androstenediol gets converted to testosterone. So what? And then aromatase, like in weight bodybuilders that take a lot of testosterone, you get a lot of this, it pushes over to here, which are the estrogens. So you need to block your aromatase, otherwise you'll get breast enlargement. So what? So basically, these are all interchangeable. And so if you get a lot of this, you're going to get a lot of that, bottom line. You need all this stuff. These are all hormone signals, but they're all closely related, and including vitamin D, which is almost identical.